knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
With fluvial and aeolian weathering environments covered, we have discussed flowing water and wind, and the weathering they can produce. Let's finish up by talking about ice. Glaciers are massive bodies of long-lasting, older-than-a-decade ice that can move under their own weight. Over 60% of Earth's freshwater is tied up in glaciers, but global climate change has caused glaciers to melt at nearly twice the rate they were melting just 20 years ago. Glaciers form on mountainous peaks and at high latitudes, where the climate is cool enough to support year-long snow cover. Glaciers are truly just giant piles of snow that compressed under their own weight into crystalline ice, and ice sheets are enormous glaciers that form over entire continents during times of global cooling. Both glaciers and ice sheets often have a layer of liquid water beneath them, where the ice would meet bedrock. This liquid layer reduces friction and allows the ice sheet to slip along the bedrock surface, where it rips up and plows Earth's surface like a giant bulldozer. In the absence of a liquid layer, ice sheets deform plastically within the ice itself and do not slip along the surface, therefore not altering the landscape much. By about 2.6 million years ago, the Laurentide ice sheet covered most of Canada and the northern third of the eastern and central United States, which began to melt and retreat around 11,600 years ago. Though the ice sheet existed throughout this period, it would expand and contract periodically in response to global climate. During the expanse of an ice sheet, it is mainly erosional, ripping up pieces of bedrock below, absorbing them into its frozen mass, and transporting them downflow. When an ice sheet expands, it scrapes the area down to the bedrock, entraining sediments from silt to huge angular boulders. In areas where silt lies between the ice and bedrock, the pressure of the ice and movement of the glacier act like a giant polisher, creating a smooth surface called a slick inside. However, when cobbles or boulders are stuck between the ice and bedrock, the bedrock is gouged or scratched, creating grooves that geologists call slicken lines, which are aligned parallel to the motion of the glacier, making them useful for studying past extinct glaciers. There are many types of glacial sediment that are all generally referred to as glacial till, but there are two main types of glacial till: basal till, which encompasses the entrained sediment at the bottom of the glacier, and ablation till, which refers to sediment that was transported near or at the top of the glacier and later deposited when the ice melted. Not only can basal till be carried by ice, but it can also be carried by subglacial streams, which can be either beneath the glacier or on its sides along the valley walls. Till that is modified or deposited by these subglacial streams gets sorted and rounded by the meltwater and is called ice contact stratified drift. But what about ablation till? How can sediment be on top of a glacier? Well, this occurs when a glacier is flowing through a valley where the top of the ice is lower than the valley walls. In such a case, sediment can then fall on top of the glacier during collapses of the valley walls. Since this sediment simply falls on top of the ice and remains there until the ice melts, it is not really modified by its environment, as with rounding due to abrasion, and it is therefore very angular. Most glacial till is deposited once it starts to retreat and melt. Moraines are large piles of poorly sorted sediments that pile up around the ice sheet as it melts. End moraines form in front of a retreating glacier, and lateral moraines form along its sides. Moraines are kind of like the pile of debris in front of an advancing bulldozer, though in actuality they can form in a variety of ways. Proglacial lakes can form between a retreating glacier and an end moraine, where large deposits of clay and silt accumulate. Glacial lakes can also form in north-draining valleys, where the drainage is dammed by the ice sheet itself. This was the case for the Great Lake Missoula, which existed in western Montana toward the end of the last ice age. Lake Missoula's ice dam would periodically fail, causing cataclysmic floods which produced gigantic dunes up to 50 feet high due to water velocities of up to 130 kilometers per hour. When ice sheets melt, they produce tremendous volumes of water with high flow velocities. large melting events can carry huge amounts of coarse and poorly sorted sediment away from the retreating ice sheet, producing laterally extensive, sheet-like deposits of well-rounded boulders, cobbles, sand, and silt called glacial outwash. In stream valleys, glacial outwash deposits can be several hundred feet thick. This type of sediment is extremely well-drained and makes great aquifers due to its high permeability. Glacial sediments generally make poor soils since they are hard and compacted, poorly chemically weathered, and composed primarily of unsorted rocky sediments. Chemical weathering helps make a good soil since it helps soften and break up rocks and leaches important nutrients from minerals, incorporating them into soil-poor waters. And since glacial sediment is young and exists in cold environments, it is not very weathered. Of course, there can be too much of a good thing, since many tropical soils have had all their nutrients removed, leaving behind mainly quartz and aluminum hydroxides. There are some glacial deposits that make fertile soil. One of them is called luss, which is wind-blown silt that accumulates downwind of the ice sheet. With that, we have covered a wide variety of weathering processes and environments, from water to air to ice, so we should now have a reasonable understanding of sedimentary processes.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.